Let's continue our discussion of the substitution rule, but let's expand it a little bit and talk about how to apply the substitution rule with definite integrals. So where we're looking for that net change or that net area between a function and the x-axis. So if we have a definite integral, there are actually two ways to do it. We can apply substitution rule exactly the way we've done it with indefinite integrals. In the end, we'll have a function of u, we'll make a back substitution so that we're back into terms of a function of x, and then we'll take that additional step where we evaluate the function that we have found from a to b. So that is one way to do it, okay? Exactly the way we've always done substitution up to this point, and in the end, just evaluate our function that we have found from a to b. Now, there is one other way that we could do it. What we could do is after we make the substitution on u, we can go ahead and also make a substitution in the bounds. So we can change our bounds to be in terms of u rather than in terms of x. So notice that we took a function that was in terms of x, we made substitution so that we are now looking at a function in terms of u, and then we changed the bounds that were in terms of x. These were x equals a and x equals b, and we also made a substitution so that they were in terms of u. Okay, so that said, I'm going to show you how to do both ways in a couple of examples, but you sort of just choose whatever you're comfortable with. If you want to change your bounds, change your bounds. If you don't feel like doing that, just make sure in the end that you go back in terms of x before you plug your bounds in. So let's go ahead and follow this through with a couple of examples. So on this first one that we're looking at, once again, we have to identify what our u is. And so I see that we have this square root of x that is nested, that it is inside this exponential. So I'm going to go ahead, u is going to be that square root of x, or x to the 1/2 if we prefer, so that our du dx, our derivative, is 1/2 x to the negative 1/2, or 1 over 2 times the square root of x. And then I'm going to separate the differential. I'm going to actually separate the differential on the next line. So then du becomes 1 over 2 root x dx. And I notice right here that I have that root x. There's not a whole lot of substitution or a whole lot of manipulation I need to do before the substitution. I'm going to multiply both sides of this equation by 2 simply to give me 2 du is equal to 1 over root x dx because I see that 1 over root x in my integral. So up here in my integral, and maybe just to remind myself that these are in terms of x as I'm making substitutions, this is x equals 4 and x equals 9, I'm going to have e to the square root of x times 1 over the square root of x dx, just separating it so we can see really clearly the substitutions. Then my u is going to go in for that power, and my du is going to go in for the 1 over root x dx. So we get e to the u and times 2 du. Now this is x equals 4 to x equals 9. So we have this definite integral. It is 2e to the u du from x equals 4 to x equals 9. And then I can integrate it. So what would be the integral of 2e to the u? Let's just keep going down. 2e to the u is just 2e to the u. Plus, normally we'd get a constant, but since we have a definite integral, we're going to be evaluating this from x equals 4 to x equals 9. So I carried, I kind of added that in and just said to remind us that we're in terms of x. And so this is the point. Normally we would just stop right here and have the plus c. Not normally, I should say. In the previous examples, we've stopped right there and had just plus c because they were indefinite integrals. We were looking for the family of functions whose integral was the function we're looking at. Now, in this case, though, we're looking to actually find the value, the net change of this function across this interval. But the function is in terms of u right now. So this is where we just need to take that one additional step, plug back in our square root of x, evaluate it from 4 to 9. So this is actually going to become 2e to the third minus 2e to the second. And that would be my answer. I guess we could factor out a 2e squared if we really wanted to, and then have e minus 1 if we wanted to write it that way. Okay. Okay, so that's my answer. So that's option one, right? Nothing different about what we've done in our previous substitution examples. just in the end, we went and we plugged in our bounds after we plugged u in, right? We made that last step just like we would have to do if it was an indefinite integral. We made that last step, substituted u back in, and then plugged in the bounds. Now, here's just one other option, and it's going to look very similar. So I'm going to actually just grab this example from partway through. So the other option is right here. Let's take this part right here and let's rewrite it. So if we've got the integral from x equals, as we're making those substitutions, x equals 9 of 2e to the u du. As we made those substitutions, if we remember how we've defined u, okay, remember that u, I'm just going to write it down here, u is actually the square root of x. When I'm making the substitutions on my integral, I can also make substitutions in my bounds. So if u equals the square root of x, when x is 4, u has to be 2. And when x is 9, u has to be 3, right? I mean, I'm simply plugging in here. I'll write that out. But that's the square root of 9, which is 3, and u square root of 4, which is 2. So I'm just plugging in. So now I've completely substituted. My integral is 100% in terms of u now, which means I don't actually have to go back in terms of x. I've already switched my bounds. So I don't have to go back in terms of x. This is just 2e to the third minus 2e to the second. Notice we get the same answer, just slightly different work. I'm not going to tell you one way is better than the other because I sort of interchangeably use these when I'm integrating. Depends on if I feel like changing the bounds, if it's easy to change the bounds, or if it's just as easy to switch back in terms of x, and I might just switch back in terms of x. So there's not one right way to go. Just know that you can change your bounds and then you don't have to go back in terms of x. Or if you're just comfortable going back in terms of x, go back in terms of x and then plug in your bounds. Let's just do one more example like this. So here's another definite integral. Picking my u, I would pick my u. You know, this one's a little tricky when we're looking at this, but I'm going to think about that relationship and knowing that the derivative of the inverse sine of x is 1, right? This is what my thought process is going to. I see that inverse sine of x, and I see a root in the bottom. And so right away, I start thinking, oh, but wait a second. The derivative of the inverse sine of x is 1 over the square root of 1 minus x squared. So that means in terms of my u, if I pick u to be the inverse sine of x, then my du dx is exactly that expression I have in the integral, 1 over the square root of 1 minus x squared. So I can separate my differential, and I can see that du is exactly the expression 1 over the square root of 1 minus x squared dx, which I have right here. All of that is my du, and this is my u. So I'll be able to plug that directly in and make the substitution. Now, remember that I have x equals 0 and I have x equals 1/2. So I'm going to go ahead and show you this one where I make this substitution on the bound. So the last one, we went all the way back in terms of x and then plugged them in for the first part. This one, I'm going to just show where we go. Let's figure out what would these bounds be in terms of u from the get-go. And we'll stick in terms of u throughout this one. So I'm going to change my bounds. I'm going to make my substitutions. This is going to be u times simply du, okay? Because inverse sine of x is u. And there's my du. So make my substitutions. And now let's figure out what u would be. So if x is equal to 0, u is the inverse sine of 0. But the inverse sine of 0 is 0. Remember, inverse sine has the restriction on the domain from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. So on the output. So u equals, and it's the domain of the inverse sine of x is from negative 1 to 1, and the output, the range, is from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. So the inverse sine of 1/2 then has to be pi over 6. So when x is 1/2, the inverse sine of 1/2 is pi over 6. So I can make those substitutions. So my u is, my lower bound becomes 0, u equals 0, and my upper bound becomes u equals pi over 6. And that's kind of a nice little way to adjust the bounds. Now, knowing when you adjust the bounds on a definite integral, you never have to go back in terms of x because we've adjusted everything over to u. So this is now u squared over 2 evaluated from 0 to pi over 6. I'll carry the u just so we can be really clear here. These are already in terms of u, so I can just go ahead and plug those in. So I'm going to get pi over 6 squared over 2 minus 0 squared over 2. And my result is pi squared over 36 divided by 2. So pi squared over 36 divided by 2, or pi squared over 72. And there is my result. Okay. All right, so that's how we deal with definite integrals. I want to do just one last example to round out this video and round out the topic on substitution. And I want to talk about where we sometimes have to do multiple substitutions. Okay, sometimes we got to get a little bit fancy with our algebra. We got to do a little more work than just straight direct substitution. So let's take a look at this one. I think this one's pretty obvious that should be my u because it's nested function. So u is x plus 3. My du on this integral, my du dx is going to be 1. So it's actually my du ends up being, separate the differential, just 1 times dx. So I can make that substitution right here. That's clear that is my du. The problem is there's some leftover junk, right? We've got this leftover stuff. So we've got this leftover stuff. So what am I going to do with all this leftover stuff? Well, that's where a little bit of algebra comes in. Sometimes we can use the way we've defined u to make another substitution. So let me write this down. This is u to the fifth. I'm going to make the substitutions. Then I have this x squared term. That's weird, funky. What am I going to do with it? Here we've got this x squared term right here. So I still have this leftover stuff. This, by the way, this integral I have that I've written right here is complete nonsense. We cannot integrate that. We've got a function of u and a function of x, right? We have not done a nice complete substitution here because I have a function here that is not of just u or x. It's a mixed up combination. And I'm being asked to integrate it with respect to u because I made the substitution on the du. So what am I going to do? Well, I'm just going to use how we've already defined u, and I'm going to make another substitution. Make another substitution. Notice that I know how to, I've defined u in terms of x. So I could write x in terms of u. X is actually just u minus 3. I can make another substitution here. So here we're using a little bit of algebra, but we can make another substitution. This becomes u minus 3 squared du. And notice by doing that, I have now created a nice little function that is all in terms of u. It is not integrable yet in terms of what we know how to integrate, simply because I don't know how to deal with this product, but I could easily expand this. So I could say, okay, this is just u to the fifth, u squared minus 6u plus 9 du, or u to the seventh minus 6u to the sixth plus 9u to the fifth du. So we get u to the 8th over 8 minus 6u to the 7th over 7 plus 9u to the 6th over 6 plus an integration constant. And now we can make our, we can do a little simplification with that 9, 6, and we can make our substitution back in terms of x. We do have an indefinite integral here. So this will be x plus 3 to the 8th over 8. Minus 6x plus 3 to the 7th over 7 plus 3 times x plus 3 to the 6th over 2 plus c. And there we have the integral in its completion with just a little bit of extra creativity, right? A little bit of extra algebra to make that second substitution, but then I was able to integrate. So making that little leap right here where we had defined u as x plus 3, but then we had that leftover stuff. So we also made a substitution for x, x being u minus 3, and then followed it through with the algebra so that we could integrate it and find that integral. Okay, so there we go. That's a nice problem to end our discussion of substitution on, one with just a little bit more complexity than some of the more basic substitution problems. But really just doing practice, doing lots and lots of integrals, that's how you're going to get better at this process of integration and this specific technique of substitution.